Hi, I'm Sean Perrin, and you're listening to episode 74 of the Clarinete Podcast, the show where I discuss all that's new and neat with clarinet with the neatest people in the industry. Unfortunately, this episode of the podcast is going to be a little different than usual. The clarinet community and everyone all around the world yesterday learned of the unfortunate passing of the wonderful teacher and bass clarinet master, the godfather of the bass clarinet, Harry Sparnai. I had the opportunity to speak with him on episode 20 of the podcast, and we had vowed to stay in touch and even do it again sometime, and it's a great reminder to me that I need to follow up with those things. The opportunity to speak with some of the greatest people and interact with them is not always there. And this is the first time, actually, that a past guest on the show that I've talked to for this program anyways has passed away. And it's been a difficult day. I've been thinking a lot about it and I really feel so fortunate for the opportunity and the chance I had to speak with him. And I can't imagine how those who interacted with him on a much more deep educational or performing basis must feel right now. And I'd like to extend my condolences to everyone in the clarinet community all around the world who's feeling this loss, especially his family. So some of these conversations I find change me more than others. And I think that's one of the great things about the podcast is that, or any podcast, not just this one, is that you listen to it and sometimes you walk away a different person. And I definitely felt like that with Harry. I'd never, literally never in my life encountered someone who loved something so much, I don't think. I think that he clearly loved the bass clarinet of a magnitude that most people will never even realize a love for anything. So I thought a lot today about whether or not I wanted to share this conversation again on the podcast here. And I've decided that I do, because although it's a lot of the stuff we talked about is not entirely relevant right now, I just really want to make sure that his musical and life message is heard by as many people as possible. And given the fact that the podcast audience has grown significantly since its inception, and especially since episode 20 when this first aired, I just think this is a great chance for everyone to reflect on some of the messages that he shared in that original episode. Thank you, Harry, for a wonderful everything contribution to the clarinet world, and you'll be sorely missed. After a short message from the sponsors, I bring you my conversation in 2016 with Harry Sparnai. The Clarinete Podcast is hosted by Mo Bleichner Music Distribution. You can check out their newest product, the $49 Match Pitch Barrel, at the clarinete.com online store. Head to clarinete.com/store. Of course, today's episode of the podcast is also brought to you by our season sponsor, D'Addario Woodwinds. And I bring you today's guest after this short message.
Sanding, shaping, balancing. For centuries, mastering your instrument meant mastering these crafts too. But now, D'Addario is refining craftsmanship for the 21st century by refining their reeds and mouthpieces with the world's most innovative techniques, so you can spend less time sanding, shaping, and balancing, and more time perfecting your own craft. To learn more about the new era of craftsmanship from D'Addario Woodwinds, visit D'Addario.com/woodwinds.
Back in 2016, when I was preparing for this interview with Harry, one of the things that I did was watch a very, very wonderful documentary about his teaching and playing career that is on YouTube, and I will be definitely sharing that in the show notes. Please go watch it. It is just a wonderful video, and it just displays his passion for the instrument and for teaching more than obviously we can get across on just the podcast here. But one of the first things I wanted to talk about was this video, because it did leave such an impression on me. So here is Harry Sparnai sharing some of the reasons behind why the video was made and what it means to him.
The story is because the composer, Roderick de Man, I think he is one of the best composers we have in Holland, and he wrote 10 pieces for me now, and he wanted to write a new piece for bass clarinet and electronics. And then the people from the documentary, they wanted to make a documentary about me. And then they thought that it would be fantastic to make a documentary immediately with the first performance of that piece. So, and that was the idea. So then it was going on and on and on. And at the end of the documentary, I played the piece, Juxtapositiones, by Roderick de Man. And that was the idea. And they came here to Spain. I was teaching still at that time at the ESMUC in Barcelona. And they came and they were filming, and they were, when my, I was speaking with Roderick, when I was working with my wife, we have a duo, etc., etc. So that, yeah, it went very well. And always when when I do things and I have to speak, it is going well because I like to speak.
You like to speak to the public?
Yes, oh yes. I always thought it is so stupid. Then I go to a contemporary concert, and then we are playing very, very, very difficult music. And we must know, we must be aware that we are doing that. And we are studying that those pieces hours and hours and hours. But the audience is only listening for 20 minutes or something. So they get an immense lot of information. So you have to introduce, you have to say something to the audience, and not like sometimes you see program notes. They are so intelligent that sometimes I read the program notes and I think, is that the piece I'm playing? I don't understand what the composer is saying. And that is not nothing for the audience. You have to keep them comfortable. You have to, we are doing something very, very, very difficult. I love it. I love it. I always loved it.
How do you entice the audience into the new music?
Yes, you know that for me, the music I always played is one of the most exciting things I had. This is always getting new pieces and always getting new problems. And you know, a lot of people, they when they get a problem, they have a problem. They said, "Oh no, I don't want to do this. I cannot do this." Blah blah. For me, it was always, when I got a problem, I was always thinking, hey, wait a moment. This is not possible, but let's see what we can do. And then the feeling after 2 months sometimes, it was possible. That feeling was fantastic. So after a while, when I played for the first time Ferniehaus, believe me, the first performance, it was in Royan Festival, I don't know anymore, 1976 or 1974, I don't know.
Are we talking about the time and motion study?
Time and motion study. And believe me, I came on stage to play the first performance, and I thought, I saw the notes, 8 music stands, and I saw the notes and I said, but I cannot play this. And then I went and I played like a madman. But after 20 performances, more or less, I got the feeling, yes, it is possible. Yes, I can play it.
So when you've accomplished a piece like that, what do you look back on the things that you thought were really difficult before? Does it feel like an accomplishment, like you just climbed a big mountain, or what does it feel like?
Oh, yes, that is. That. And for me, that has been always a feeling to go on. And so I never said immediately, this is impossible. I looked and I thought, I think impossible. And then, you know, nearly everything there is a possibility, especially the bass clarinet is such a fantastic instrument. And we have, for example, in the third register, we have so many possibilities with different fingerings. And so sometimes when there is a phrase impossible because of one note, and you say, oh, wow, when that F sharp should have been different. And then looking, okay, thinking F sharp is an overblown note of the C sharp, but also from the F sharp. And thinking. And then suddenly I got another fingering. So that's why you see in my book sometimes a high note with 10 fingerings.
Yeah, oh, absolutely.
And that is fantastic. I love that. Oh, yeah, I love that.
So in the documentary, actually, you mentioned that you really love when students ask to play more contemporary music. You feel almost as though you've made converts.
Yeah.
What is it so inspiring to you about new music and sharing that with others?
Now, not it is not only the new music. For me, new music is kind of a picture of now, of today. Sometimes I listen to a new piece by a composer, and I think, it sounds good, but the man is missing a lot of history. What is happening? What is happening? And for me, when we play contemporary music, of course, but I told you already, we have to be very careful because it is very difficult. And I don't want, and that's why I want to not push them, not press them, push them. Please go on with contemporary music. The bass clarinet is a so-called new instrument. I mean new instrument. The first bass clarinet, don't laugh, but it is really true, is from 1740-50. But nobody wanted to play it, and we had to wait till Adolf Sax, and then the bass clarinet became more and more an instrument, but always an instrument in the orchestra and not before the orchestra.
Yeah, it was never regarded as a solo instrument.
No, never.
That actually takes me to my next question. Many would regard you as the person who raised the bass clarinet's status to that of a solo instrument. You really kind of single-handedly brought it to this place. But many students actually still struggle with having the bass clarinet receive that status. And what are your thoughts on that issue as far as it goes?
This is really very difficult because when I started in a country, I'm living now in Spain, but I'm from Holland, you know.
Yeah.
And in Holland, we have had a period so fantastic. Everything was possible. Everything was possible. And when I started with the bass clarinet and I went on and on and on, there was a director at the Conservatory of Amsterdam who said, yes, but this is so fantastic. I want to have to include this in the whole, year, the school.
Semester?
Yeah, the master. And fantastic. So I was, I think, the first who was teaching the bass clarinet. And then it was amazing. I had sometimes alone at the conservatory, more students than the three clarinet professors together.
Wow.
I had classes from the last years, I had 15 till 20 students. They came from America, from all the places they came. And now we are going back to the contemporary music. What I think, when you play the bass clarinet, and it is really a new instrument. You can say it is a new instrument because a real instrument to play it fantastically is from 1950, 1960. Eh? The first instrument I got was also quite terrible. Eh? Quite terrible. So I had to speak a lot with the factory, but they wanted to do it. And now we have a perfect instrument. But when you want to play the instrument, the bass clarinet, I think, please don't play the suites from Bach. I love the suites from Bach, but it is for cello and not for bass clarinet. Bach didn't know the bass clarinet. The bass clarinet did not exist. Just please don't play Bach.
During Bach's time, though, wasn't he very open to transcribing?
Oh, yes. That is for sure. You can do it. And always, my students, when they come to me, they have to practice what I say, but not to play what I am playing. No. When they want to play Bach, they play Bach.
Oh, I see.
But when a student is coming to me, I only had it in my whole career, only with one student, and the student only wants to play transcriptions from Vivaldi, Bach, etc., then I say, please, you have to find another teacher, because that is not the way I'm teaching bass clarinet. You can do Bach, the transcriptions, and you can play the cello sonata from Debussy. You can do it, but you also have to play Xenakis, because that is the bass clarinet from now.
So I see what you're saying. You're saying that you can't just play the old repertoire. You really have to get into the new stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, and do you know who Catherine Ladano is? She's a bass clarinetist in Canada here. And we were chatting recently about this on another episode of the podcast, because here there's only two universities, I think, in all of Canada that offer a bass clarinet degree. What's the situation like over in Europe now?
It is changing, but not always in the best way, I must say. Amsterdam is more or less okay. I'm not teaching there anymore, and the professor there now is not doing a lot, but it is a pity. But in Groningen, in the north of Holland, there is now a young girl, or young, a former student of mine, Fies Schouten, doing a master. In Italy, there are masters. In England, there are masters. But still, in Austria, are masters. So it is coming. But in Rotterdam, for example, there was my former student, Henri Bock, and they stopped with the bassline.
Mm-hmm.
So it is fighting, still fighting, and going on and going on. And now, with all the crisis there is in the whole world financially, it is not easier.
When you were a student trying to pursue this path, it must have been even more difficult back then. What was it like?
No, I didn't feel it was difficult, no.
Oh, no? Okay, because yeah, many people today, for example, who want to play bass as a solo instrument, I think they face some resistance to that.
Oh, yes, but I had a lot of resistance. Oh, you mean that? But
that's what I mean. Sorry, yeah.
I love to have resistance. So, no. So that is not a problem for me. So when I, listen, my beginning was a little bit different. Because when I was young, you know that, you read the book, I played saxophone, the tenor saxophone. And when I wanted to be a musician, my father said, okay, you have to study at the conservatory because there are enough street musicians. I want that you study. Okay, and I go to the conservatory. But at that time, the saxophone was completely forbidden. It was a dirty instrument. It was, we are speaking about 1960, eh? 1960.
Yeah.
Now the saxophone is accepted in all the places, but not in my time. No, man, not at all. So I came there with my saxophone, and they looked at me very, very strange, and they said, "But what are you playing?" And I said, "I want to play You Needn't from Thelonious Monk." Mm-hmm. And they said, "What?" And I was playing at the tenor sax, and I made an improvisation, blah blah blah. And nobody wanted to have me. Only one guy, and that was the clarinet professor. He said, "Yes, I want that guy. I want him." And he spoke with me, and he said, "Yeah, but you have to speak. You have to play clarinet. But don't worry, that's also good for your saxophone technique." And I said, "Okay, no problem. I wanted to be a musician, so I started clarinet. But I always missed the sound of the tenor saxophone. So I was practicing more and more and more and more, and life changed. I started playing more clarinet, always more contemporary pieces than the classical pieces. I remember one time I was playing Weber, and my professor looked at me and he said to me, "You don't like it, eh?" And I said, "No, I don't like it at all. I'm sorry." And he said to me, "Yes, but you have to practice it." Is that okay? No problem. "But you don't need to play it." Oh, say, "Thank you very much."
So you really think, did your father's encouragement then to seek formal training, how did that shape your career then? How is it different than it would have been?
Oh, I think it would have been completely different, because my idea was working, for example, in a shop, and in the evening playing in a jazz club or with friends, etc., etc. No, it should have been completely different. Completely different. But now I want to go on with at the end of the study, I had already two degrees for the normal clarinet. And then my professor came with a big case. And I thought, hey, saxophone, what is this? And then he opened, and there was a bass clarinet. And he was a fantastic professor. I loved him, Rui Otto. He was fantastic. And he said to all the students who were, "Oh, you can blow a little bit." And everybody was blowing a little bit, and everybody had a problem. And believe me or not, you can ask him. He is still alive. He is 93.
Wow.
I played 3-4 notes. I looked at him and I said, "Yes, but this is the instrument I want to play." And he looked at me and he said, no, Harry, please don't do this. Don't do this. You cannot earn your money. Please don't. Yes, I want to play this instrument. I'm sorry. So I finished my last degree for normal clarinet. I closed my cases. And then I had to sell my tenor saxophone to buy a bass clarinet. And then I started. It was 1967 or 66. Yeah.
But you were so sure. So you were so sure about the bass clarinet that you sold your beloved tenor sax, though.
Yeah. But I have him back. Eh? I have him back now.
Oh, you have one again?
Yeah.
So what is it about the deep, rich tone that really draws you to those instruments? Like, you say that even when you were playing clarinet, like, you kind of missed that part about the tenor sax, and then bass clarinet was just the best of both worlds. So what is it?
Yeah, it is not only the lower note. It is the possibilities from all the registers. Listen to the bass clarinet. We can do, for example, I don't know if you know the clarinet solitude by Yoji Yuasai, a Japanese composer. It is a beautiful piece, but it is for clarinet, original for clarinet, and it is going up to the high E flat, this above the high C. Yes?
Yes. So four ledger lines.
I don't know how many lines, but a lot. Yeah?
Are we talking the C above super C? Sorry, the E flat above super C?
Yeah, the super C. Yeah.
So this is
I don't know, the E flat, I think with 8 lines or 9 lines or something like that.
My God.
That E flat, I mean.
Mm-hmm.
So when I ask you to play that E flat, you will not be very happy.
I will run screaming.
and when I ask you, please, not only you have to play in that E-flat, but you have to play it also pianissimo. I think you want to kill me. Okay, now the bass clarinet. We can do anything. I can play that E-flat and even a lot higher, but I can play that E-flat fortissimo, but I also can play it pianissimo. And in the lower register, I can play the low C fortissimo, but I can play it so soft that you only feel nearly the vibrations. So not one instrument can do that. Not the contrabassoon, who is playing the low notes. They never can play pianissimo so soft in a low register as we can.
Mm-hmm.
And a normal clarinet never can play so soft in the high register as we can. So the bass clarinet can do, in fact, I must be honest, everything. We have reflectors, we can do anything. Anything what you want, we can do it. All the multiphonics on the bass clarinet. I'm sorry, I always say to the clarinet player, I'm so sorry for you, but everything what sounds good on a clarinet sounds a lot better on the bass clarinet. And especially those special effects like the multiphonics. We have multiphonics, they can sound very ugly. But we have also multiphonics. They are so beautiful, so beautiful. They'll listen to the multiphonics on a clarinet. When they succeed, they are not always very lovely, no?
Yeah, I agree. I think you referred to the bass clarinet once as the emperor of the instruments. Is that true?
Yeah, I said that, yes. That's completely true, completely true. But the joke is, and that is, I have to explain a little bit. My wife is organist. And she said, Sylvia said to me once, Mozart said that the organ is the king of instruments. And my answer was immediately, yes, because he didn't know the bass clarinet, that's the emperor. And from that moment on, we are speaking about the emperor. Also, my students, they are speaking the emperor of instruments.
That's fantastic. So let's go back to when you were a student for a second. I mean, really early, back to that day when your parents bought you that saxophone. Your mom said she went out for the afternoon and left you at home with this saxophone. And when they came home, you were playing. What were those few hours like?
Fantastic. I get the feeling. I opened the case and I saw the saxophone. I knew a little bit about the mouthpiece and the reed, not from the saxophone, because I had a young friend who played the clarinet in a harmony band. So I knew, and I was trying this, and you don't need to be very intelligent to know when you see the piano also, you go up, etc. So I saw the keys, and I think, okay, I have to close the keys, And I did it in my mouth and I start blowing, of course, completely wrong. So no turning right, but I was blowing and there came a note. So I, hey, that's lovely. And then I close and key, hey, that's a lower note. That is ah. So that when I close the key, that's okay. So, and that was going on. And then after 3-4 hours, I played, oh yeah, I never forget that. And a tune very popular in that period, it was called Tequila.
Oh yes,
and, yeah, you can, you know it probably.
Yes.
Only 3 notes or 4 notes, so I did not play a saxophone concerto, eh? But I played that. So they came at home, my father and mother, and I said, "Okay, sit down." And they sit down, and I played do 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 do. So and the next day I went to the shop where they bought the saxophone and I said, I want to have somebody who give me lessons. And the man said, yeah, but I can do it. And then after a year, he said, no, you have to find another guy because I cannot teach you anymore. And then I said to my father, okay, I want to do something. I want to be a professional musician. And then, then the whole story starts at the conservatory.
So then that takes us, you know, to the, we've covered some great stuff there, actually. That's really interesting stories. But you were also a fantastic teacher and really passionate about teaching. And you've now taught many students over the years, many, many students. What is the most important thing that you want students to take away from the lessons with you?
When they love the music and their instrument, that is something essential. That is the most important thing. So I also wanted, and I did not go to the lessons with the feeling, now I want to make my students happy. No, I want they, I'm doing what I'm doing, and I want that they go home with a feeling from, ah, I'm doing something lovely, something fantastic. I'm playing bass line. Wow.
So just to fall in love with the instrument.
Yeah, yeah. And I must say that a lot of crazy people walking around in this world now playing bass line, they are students of mine, former students, or students of mine.
Yeah, many of them are, probably most of them.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's amazing.
And that gives a very, very good feeling. So then I hear something, and sometimes I hear a guy, and I said, wow, man, you are playing the piece easier than when I played the piece 50 years ago. No, but that is strange. That is something what I always, it's so strange for me that it is like with Olympic Games. It is the 100 meters for the men under the 10 seconds was impossible in my time. And now it is 9.3.
Yeah.
And if we, it will be once 8.9 or something. It is also with those young guys they are playing. I heard a young guy during the Clarinet Fest in Madrid. And he played Hugo Queiroz from Portugal. And he played Time and Motion Study. Okay, he played Time and Motion Study.
Yeah, I actually just saw Laurie Friedman play that in Calgary here a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, Laurie is a former student of mine.
Yes, she is. Yeah. So that's a lot about, you know, when you were a student and your students now. But of course, you've also completely pioneered the repertoire for bass clarinet. I wrote here, which your bio says 500 pieces, but you corrected said 650?
650, yes.
650 pieces have been written for you specifically, is that?
Yeah.
Wow,
yeah.
That's incredible. And you've worked with some amazing composers, including Brian Ferneyhough, Luciano Berio, Morton Feldman, Ioannis Xenakis, and many others.
Yeah. Yeah.
What was it like bringing pieces to life with these amazing composers and their incredible insight and compositional minds?
Yeah, that is a fantastic feeling. That's the only thing I can say. And it is not only those guys, but also a man like Isang Jung. They wrote masterpieces for the bass clarinet, and then getting the piece and the opening the piece and looking at the notes, and I got of course, after a while, routine enough and opening the piece, and you say, wow, my, that is a piece. That is something fantastic. And yeah, that is fun. That's great.
Is there a particular memory from working with any of them that comes to mind?
Oh man, how many times do we have? No, there's always, for example, Isang Jung is, in my opinion, he wrote the monologue for bass clarinet. I think that is one of the masterpieces. And a masterpiece is also because he is not using one special effect. You know, sometimes I say to composers, and I also wrote it in my book, that I'm afraid to include, for example, this or this or this, because sometimes I got pieces and I thought, yeah, but listen, a piece is not a better piece because there are included 600 multiphonics and 1500 slap tones, etc. No, that is a misunderstanding. Of course you can use multiphonics and a lot of multiphonics and a lot of, but it is not like this, that when you use it, the piece is a better piece. And that's why the piece of Isang Jung is so incredible, beautiful, and there is not even a flutter tone in the piece.
Mm-hmm.
And that story is interesting because I wanted a piece, and I'm quite direct. So I go to the composer or I write them. And I met him in a festival. I said, Mr. Jung, I want the piece for bass clarinet. Oh, it's interesting. And then he started asking, yes, but bass clarinet, can you play a staccato? Listen. So I took my bass clarinet. Oh, beautiful. So a year later, I saw him in another festival. And Mr. Jung, my piece, yeah. But can you play long slurs? Okay, to my hotel room, I played long slurs. Oh, beautiful. And it took 6 years. And then suddenly I got a phone call, I never forget it, on a Sunday morning, 9:30. And he said, Harry, this is Isang, your piece is ready. I said, no, yes.
Wow.
And then I played the world's first performance 2 weeks later in Australia. I was practicing in the airplane.
Wow.
Yeah, 30 hours looking at the notes, remembering the notes, blah, blah, blah. Practicing in Melbourne for hours in my hotel. I said to the hotel people, please, I have to practice. So that is with something what I had with the composer, but also with the Yuasa, I told you, the piece with the clarinet with the high E flat, I met him in Japan and I said, listen, I saw that your piece and I listened to the piece, but the piece is much better for the bass clarinet. And he said, no, see, yeah, it's much better because you want to have this pianissimo and you cannot do it. No, on the clarinet, it's, yeah, but I can do it. No, yes, okay. I said, he said, can I hear it? Of course you can hear it because I prepared it. And then a former student of mine from Japan was there also, and I played the piece for him, and he did not say anything. But believe me, he did not say anything. So he went home with the students because the student brought him to his house. As he came back, and I said to Ikoko, but he didn't like it, eh? And he said, no, that is it, no. He was so impressed, he could not find words to speak with you anymore. And it is true. On bass clarinet, the piece is gorgeous. And on clarinet, it is suffering. It is also working, but the multiphonics are more ugly. The higher notes are really
shrill, the word.
Yeah. Oh.
Very pointy. So do you think, like, a lot of people regard you then as a pioneer of the bass clarinet, but do you think that you sort of brought the attention of composers to the instrument then as itself? Like, had you not found it, someone else would have brought them out anyways? It's so gorgeous.
Now, listen. First of all, you have to say that was Josef Horák. He is from Czechoslovakia.
Mm-hmm.
But he did not go on in the way I went on. So
yes.
He went on and with playing sonatas from Martinu, etc.
Mm-hmm.
And That was not my idea. So I went on with the Bassliner developing the instrument like it is now. Also, the changes in the instrument, a lot of the changes are because I went to the factory, Buffet Crampon, and I said, listen, I have to play this, and it is not possible with this kind of the keys. So, for example, when my first bass clarinet, when I played a low C, I had to use three fingers. So the two little fingers of my left and right hand and my thumb. Otherwise, I could not play one low C.
Yeah.
So I said, I never can play a fast phrase when I have to use my three fingers because after the C, and I cannot play another note anymore. So now you can play the C with only the thumb and the C sharp only the thumb. So that is happening after speaking with the factory, yes.
How many years have you been in collaboration with Buffet like that?
Oof. Oy, oy.
Sounds like many.
Many years. I started when my first bass clarinet was a very old model because I don't have a lot of money, and LeBlanc, and did not work very well. But it is not so bad to start with an instrument which is not working very well, because then the second instrument is immediately working a lot and a lot better. So the LeBlanc was not the best one. And then I had a Selmer, which was okay. It's really okay. And then I went to the Buffet. And from that moment on, I played always Buffet. Years. But still, now I'm let's say, a pensioner. But still, when I was in a factory, I always could say, please, that F-sharp key is a little bit strange. Can we do something? Or overblowing notes are in that register, blah, and they always are working with the instrument. That's really impressive.
So what's left to improve then? What is something else that you would still change with the instrument? Or is it perfect?
No. The first instrument was not perfect. Now, I nearly can say it is perfect, yes. The last models are even much better than the models I had before.
Wow. So it's just kind of an intertwined relationship. You've brought more out of the instrument. It's allowed you to improve it.
Not only me, there are also classical players from the orchestra who were saying, yeah, but this and this and this. I change a lot for for the music I am playing. Yes.
Yes, absolutely. So when it comes to contemporary pieces, and we sort of touched on this a minute ago, but this is a listener question, actually. What do you find sets apart the really great pieces from the mediocre ones? Like, what is it that just puts it over the edge?
Yeah, but that is completely personal. I have pieces. I said, this is a masterpiece. And I never got one good review from the piece. That is very difficult. It is very, what do you feel? What do you feel? I have pieces, and I really think they are masterpieces, like the Claudio Ambrosini, that Capriccio for bass clarinet. Mm-hmm. And there are people, they say, but what are you doing with the instrument? Now that is, I open a piece and I see this is for sure a piece which I play more than one time.
You can tell that from when you first look at it?
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. How do you know? You just get a sense?
Yeah, I don't know. That is because I played so many pieces. I look at pieces and said, yeah, this is a piece I will play more. And sometimes I see and said, okay, that is very usable, because there are also pieces which are not very deep, not very, but working very, very well for my normally quite hectic programs, because the programs I did, I'm now collecting all my recordings, because I want to have my recordings. And sometimes I listen to programs and I said, wow, that's poor public. They had a lot to listen to and a lot of difficult things. And I always try then in the middle to have a piece which is a little bit, but contemporary, not Bach or Vivaldi, no, contemporary, to have a little bit, they can relax a little bit. So, and so some of the pieces are very usable. So I see a look and I said, okay, that's this I can use. And then the other pieces like the Jung and the Ambrosini, but also the Ferneyhough, also, this is incredible difficult, but it is something that is happening 9 minutes, something that not one person in the audience is not impressed. There is something happening. So those pieces, let's say I have 650 pieces and there are some masterpieces, not 650. No. There are also not very good pieces, yes.
So I do want to get to your search for your recordings in a second here, but before we move on from the composers, I'm specifically interested, I'm not sure exactly why, but in Morton Feldman, what was he like? He's so enigmatic and sort of...
You know, the first time I met him, I was so surprised because it was a very big man, very low voice. And the contrary, the music he is writing, very soft and delicate music. And this man, big, great, and he says, hello, Harry, how are you?
Yeah.
And he wrote that piece, and that is, the piece is so breakable, so difficult, but in a complete different way. It is not, the fingers are not difficult at all. But the embouchure, that is very, very complicated because you have to do it soft. You have to not listen to any attack because the percussion players are playing like a wind. It is beautiful. It's always a success. It was always a success for with the audience. They were nearly sleeping there. Wow.
And what is the title of that piece for the listeners?
For bass line and the percussion. The score is a little bit... I told him also that he wrote it a little bit strange because the bass clarinet is playing a lot of bar changes, mm-hmm. which are not a problem at all. But the percussion players are playing only 3/4 bars. But the 3/4 bars are as big as the 3/8 bar from the bass clarinet. So you cannot, the parts are not connected to each other. So when I go to the next bar, is in fact in the 3/4 bar from the percussion players, but you don't see it. So visual, it is a very bad score.
So I'm confused then. So is it not meant to be interpreted then? Maybe, well, I guess you played it and talked to him, so you would know better than me, but why wouldn't he just make the 3/8 bar half the size?
I don't know. Weird. I said to him, it is a little bit complicated, ha, 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 and then it was over. And so I played it, and I was counting, and the percussion players were counting. And then always after, I think it are 3 sections, and then always after about 40 bars or 30 bars, we are together. Hmm. So then I made the signal to the percussion players, and then we went on. Also, it was not very important because they are making not a rhythmical 3/4 bar. It is a kind of color, beautiful color, and I am playing the rhythm. So yeah. It was very important, but it was confusing. Yes, it was confusing. So I rewrote my part on only one paper. And it was solved. I rewrote so many pieces. I got so many manuscripts that I was so used to it to rewrite music. And rewriting music, you learn also a lot. This immediately you write a phrase and you said, "Oh wow, this is difficult. This I have to look at."
So that piece in particular is much more accessible than much of other pieces by Morton Feldman. I mean, some of his were 4 or 6 hours long.
No. This would be impossible for the bass line.
Yeah.
With those long, soft notes, impossible. The 90 minutes it is, was already, after 90 minutes, I had something. Now I need to have a break because my lips, they are not very happy.
Do you think that was the only reason he chose to write this piece in shorter form, or?
I don't know. I really don't know. Okay. He liked it very much. We have had 2 days we were together in Middelburg, in the south of Netherlands, during a festival.
Mm-hmm.
And then I played it several times with several percussion players. And now I like the piece. I like the piece.
What about your time with Xenakis? He famously not only worked as a musician, but also as an architect and under the study of Le Corbusier. Would you share a story about him?
Yeah, with him I worked a lot because he wanted to write a piece, and that took him 20 years to write a piece.
Wow.
And he started immediately when he started writing the piece and we were speaking together. He said, I never forget that I get a letter from a certain guy called Harry Sparnay. And he is asking me to write a piece for bass clarinet. And I was laughing so much. I thought, bass clarinet, what a strange guy. No, no, it's impossible, impossible. But 20 years later, he wrote a piece.
So he did it.
Yeah, he did it.
After all that time.
And it is a lovely piece also. It is a different piece. It is a different piece than the other Xenakis pieces. For example, there are two little cadenzas. And they are nearly tonal, nearly tonal, nearly tonal. And what I love from him, he didn't like vibrato. And in all his pieces, nearly was written no vibrato. But that no vibrato was not vibrato, what I think is lovely. He didn't want that vibrato from those singers, which is sometimes a half tone or something.
So wide, yeah.
He did not want it. So I said to him, listen, Giannis, this cadenza is so lovely. I want to have a little. Of course you can do that. Okay, clear. So we did. And I played that piece quite often. Yes. Also with other ensembles. Yes. Lovely piece. So this is what the students have to study, not to play. When they don't like it, it is the same what my teacher did with Weber, with me. I'm doing with those pieces. And so you have to know this exists. And when you don't want to play it, no, it's no problem for me. But you have to play it, to practice it.
So, of course, working with these composers, it often leads to recordings, and you've been on dozens and dozens. Do you have an actual number?
I don't know.
So many? Do you view the recordings as a snapshot of a live experience, or are they their own entity? Or what is your sort of thought on making recordings?
Honestly spoken, I didn't like it at all.
You don't like recording?
No. Oh, this has nothing. I have nothing to do with making music, in my opinion. No. You have to play with a red light and a green light, and the red light tells you now you have to play, and the green light tells you now you can speak. This has nothing to do with music, in my opinion. I don't like it. No.
So I was going to ask you to share an interesting studio moment, but...
Interesting studio moments is when the red light became green and it was finished. Also, now I'm collecting my recordings. When I was 70, I stopped playing. And not because I don't like the music and I don't like my instrument, no. The motivation of practicing every day 4 or 5 hours, that's over, that's gone. So I think when you don't practice anymore, don't play. And I'm not a guy, and I hated that always when I heard those persons who said, but you can play contemporary music. Nobody hears when you make a mistake. And then I said, yes, but you hear it yourself. I always said to the people, I hear when I make something, play something wrong. So I don't want that. So I said to myself, 70 is a nice year, a nice age. I have played a lot of pieces. So I stop. There are enough young people. They can go on with the bass clarinet, and they will go on because they are as crazy as I am. I was. So I stopped. And then I said, I would love to hear some other pieces, old pieces by me, the playing. So then I started, And that's going very well. I have already about 70 giga. So it's going well. But now is the interesting thing. I also ask people to help me when they find something, but I'm not interested in the recordings, the CDs. No. I want the live recordings. And sometimes I hear recordings. I got a CD. No, of course not. In that time, there was no CD. I got a cassette from New York, and I played in the FLIA, and it was in 1976. And I listened to the cassette, and I said to myself, no, Sparnay, that was not bad at all. Not bad at all. And sometimes it is that I think, no, this was not your best day. But that's okay. But the live recordings are mostly much more interesting than the studio recordings. I can hear it when I play. I copied cassettes, and then I said, okay, that's a recording.
So that's more what you're looking for, is the live versions?
Yeah. And I'm playing with an audience. I want to see, I want to feel the audience, and not a green light or a red light. No. It has nothing to do with making music, in my opinion.
So Clarinet's got a lot of listeners now, I think. How could we help you with this goal? Like, is there a list of certain concerts you specifically would like, or do you have a way to sort of keep track of this, or what's the method here?
You know, the problem is I played so many concerts that I did not, of course, not have all the programs. So sometimes people sending me things I didn't know at all. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I have programs and I'm asking the organization, do you have recordings? But at that time, they were not as keen to make recordings from all the concerts. So a lot, I never will get all my recordings. That's impossible. But I try to get as most as possible. And I have, from a lot of pieces, I have at least one recording that I would like to have. So one recording from the pieces I played.
So, and if we look back, though, you've played so many pieces. We got our work cut out for us here. So
A lot.
So I guess to listeners, what that means is that if you're at a university or some institution where you know of that Harry has played in the past, have a look through the archives, see if you can find anything.
Please. Yeah,
let's see if we can send some stuff along. And what about, like, Harry, if we can get something, is an MP3 okay? Can we just email it to you?
Oh, yeah, you can MP3 or a WAV or something. Yes, you can do it. Of course.
Okay. Well, yeah, let's look into this. I think that's kind of a cool project. So that's the challenge I put out there to those listening, is let's try and get some recordings on to Harry here.
Yeah. That would be fantastic.
So one more thing before we kind of do the lightning round. And the lightning round is just a quick five questions at the end that are each to be answered in under a minute. But I got an email this morning. You say that you've sort of more or less retired, but I got an email from the Bass Clarinet Festival in Belgium saying that you're speaking there. What's that all about?
I'm speaking there.
So you've retired from performing actively, but you're still very much involved.
But I still, listen, I get nearly, not every day, but every week, I get a question from a bass clarinet player. Please, Mr. Sparnay, this piece I'm practicing, I have a problem, page 4. Can you, of course I help. And when I have a recording, I send a recording also. That is going on. But playing, no. Because when I want to play the music I want to play, and with my instrument, I have to practice, and otherwise, no playing. So I don't play. I'm playing now a saxophone with my old friends here, and playing a little bit jazz. I love it.
So one thing I actually almost forgot to ask you about, which is absurd, you're like a master of extended techniques for the bass clarinet. What are your thoughts on that? And would you explain kind of some of these techniques that people are now using almost, what's the word? Everywhere. These techniques are very common now, but back at the beginning, you founded a lot of them. What are your thoughts on this?
Yeah. You know, I heard things on a saxophone and I thought, this is interesting. Like the slap tone, on the bass clarinet, it is so incredible, beautiful. You can play in tune with a sleptone on the clarinet. It is poor. It doesn't sound a lot, but on the bass clarinet it sounds perfect. And then with the multiphonics, yeah, I had to find out myself. So trying sometimes with, especially with the higher notes, because I have to explain something. In 1974, Enrique Raschach, he's a Spanish composer, he wrote Chimera for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I got the score, and it was a handwritten score. And he had erased the achtva sign in a certain place. And I phoned him and I said, Enrique, listen, that part, you want to have an achtva, an octave higher, no? Yes, but I made a mistake, that is not possible. I said, no, because I looked at the notes and that must be impressive when we can do this. And he said, but can you do that? I said, not now, but perhaps tomorrow. So, no, that was a joke because it was not tomorrow. And that's going up to the B flat, but the B flat, not the B flat with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines, but the B flat octave higher.
Mm-hmm.
So high.
Very high.
For that time, very, 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 very high. But the idea, I saw the notes and I said, wow. Because the in that part, the music was split and one part of the melody was going up and one part was going down and down and down and up and up and up. And then at the end, we had nearly the low C and that high B flat. And I said, wow, when is that succeed? When this is possible, that sounds will sound very great. So then I was trying, other day trying, really till nearly the blood was in my lips. I could not play anymore. But I found the fingerings. Yeah, of course you find the fingerings. You can go as high as you want. But, and that's why I was afraid after a while, and when I wrote a book, to include it, because when I played that, there came composers, they said, wow, is that possible on bass clarinet? And then I sometimes got a piece for bass clarinet which sounded more like an oversexed E flat clarinet. And that is horrible. So I tell the composers now, and I saw that I'm telling my students, I said, listen, you know how to do this, but when there is a composer closer than 2 meters with you, don't say anything.
What do you
mean? Don't mention it is possible to play so high, because some of the composers immediately start using it. So when the composer is asking you, is this possible, please look a little bit difficult. Then you said, no, perhaps. Perhaps, but don't make the mistake I did, because I was young and I wanted to do it. And a composer asked me, do you know circular breathing on the bass clarinet? And I said, stupid. I said, of course. And he wrote a piece, 23 minutes circular breathing.
Oh my God.
Believe me, because I tried it. Of course I tried it. But after 9 minutes, there are coming black spots at the sides of your eyes, and you are shaking a little bit.
Well, yeah, I mean, just because something's possible, maybe doesn't mean it should be done, right?
and at that moment, it is really a lot better to take a little bit breath, because your brains and your heart will say, listen, man, this is a little bit too much. So for that reason, I always told my students, please, don't say too much. When they ask you, do you know circular breathing? Well, it's possible, but we have to look where and how and when. But don't do what I said. Yes, of course, everything is possible.
Hey, one more thing. There's another listener question I almost forgot about. You say that you can't get a great tone on clarinet until you can get a great tone with a mouthpiece and a garden hose. Have you actually tried this?
Yeah. No, but you know the problem is, and I think that is something important. You know, you have now wooden bells. You have, I don't know what kind of other things. And of course, when you want to buy it, buy it. But please don't buy it with the idea, now my tone is immediately better. No, 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 no. That is a mistake. That is a mistake. That is a mistake. It helps you, but not making your horrible tone suddenly a beautiful tone. No, no, no. A beautiful tone is coming from your heart. You have to work for it. And I have a very nice example. There is coming a guy from Korea, and he came at the class, and he had a crystal mouthpiece. He had a special ligature. He had a wooden bell, everything. He had everything, everything. And I thought, hey, a student is starting with, okay, okay, why not, why not? And he's playing, and it sounded horrible, horrible. Mm-hmm. And I said to him, listen, listen. Next week you come back, and then have your normal bell, you have your normal mouthpiece, what's with the instrument, you have your normal ligature, we start with, okay, okay. And he came, and we were working, working, working. And after 4 months, 4 or 5 months, which is not so bad, he said to me, himself, it sounds better. And I said, it sounds a lot better. And I said to him, and now you can do what you want. And he came back the week later with the wooden bell, but the other things though. But the wooden bell, he said, I love it. Okay, beautiful. No problem at all. So that is the idea. So you can buy it, of course. There are a lot of very good players who are playing with the wooden bell. But don't go buy it with the idea, okay, my tone is horrible, and now I buy for a lot of money a wooden bell, and now my tone is fantastic. No, no, no. That's not true. And that's why I told you, when you cannot make a beautiful tone with a horse, how do you say that, the wooden... Then forget it.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's true. I mean, it's funny because you can take the greatest player in the world and throw him on a student clarinet, and all of a sudden he still sounds great, you know?
Yeah.
So for the lightning round, these are all questions to be answered in a minute or less. And the first one is, I know that you've retired, but if I was to walk over to your music stand right now, what would I find? What are you
working on? Music stand. Okay. Softly as the morning sunrise.
So, and this is music you said you're playing for your tenor sax?
Yeah.
What is one book that you'd recommend all clarinetists read?
Yeah, that is difficult because I have a lot of books with what I love to read, but it is in German, and that is for a lot of people not, for Dutch people it is normal, but the biography from Isang Jung.
Mm.
That's very, very, very interesting, very interesting.
And that's not available in English though?
I don't think so.
Okay. No. What is the best piece of advice you ever received, and who gave it to you?
Oh, that is from my former professor.
Yes.
He said always to me, follow your dream.
Who was that?
My former teacher, Ruud Otto.
And he's still alive. I should try and get in touch with him.
No, I don't think so. He is now really getting old.
Oh, yes. He said he's 93.
Yeah. But no. He was 93 when he came. He was on my, when I was 70, when I stopped. And he came to me. It was so lovely. And so now he's 95.
Wow.
And he came to me. He took my hand and he said, but Harry, why are you stopping? It sounds so good.
Where is he living now?
He is living in Haarlem in Holland.
Okay, so what is your all-time favorite piece of music? That's a very hard question, but is there something that stands out?
Oof, that's difficult. I think probably I will bring with me the clarinet quintet by Brahms.
Oh, interesting.
Because that is a guy, the composer, I always said, that's a pity he and Debussy that they didn't write for the bass clarinet. That's Brahms. Yeah. The quintet is gorgeous, but there are also other pieces which I think are gorgeous, classical pieces. When you listen to the beginning of the Requiem from Mozart, that is so incredible. Or the beginning from the Unfinished Symphony by Schubert, that is so incredible, beautiful. That is different, eh?
Yeah. I was expecting something very contemporary.
Yeah. No, contemporary, less contemporary, but the masterpiece is, of course, the Sacre du Printemps. That is a masterpiece.
Yes.
And then you have what I think is very, very exciting is there are a lot of pieces by Elliot Carter.
Yes. Gras is a great one for clarinet players looking for something really cool to play.
Yeah, but also ensemble pieces. Eh? I played not only when I played still concert, I did not only play solo or with my trio or yes. with my wife, the duo, but I also played in the Arsco ensemble because I loved it to play in an ensemble. And then we did a lot of pieces.
If you could meet any musician or composer, past or present, who would it be and why?
Oh, those two, Brahms and Debussy.
So you just really love their music, eh? The composition.
Debussy, there is a photo that's also in my book that he is leaning on a bass clarinet and he never wrote for the bass clarinet. He wrote for a saxophone, but not for the bass clarinet. And the normal clarinet, of course, but not for the bass clarinet. And that is a pity. It's a pity. That's a real pity. And Brahms is also, that's a pity. That's a pity. But that is, we have to live with that. That is, does not exist, so...
Well, Brahms might have come around to it, but he died shortly after writing his clarinet sonatas.
Yeah, it's a pity, yeah.
So Debussy might have been a bit early. What do you think? You think Debussy would have encountered a bass clarinet suitable at that time?
I think so. Yeah? I think so. But you know, the problem is, in that time, in his surrounding, his place, there was not a guy who was crazy with the bass clarinet. So... No, but it is true that look at pieces by Wagner and Strauss. There must be, and the orchestras he was writing for there must be a guy who was playing the bass clarinet quite well because the parts are not easy, eh?
Yeah, it's interesting. Why didn't the interest as the bass clarinet as a solo instrument come sooner, I guess?
Yeah.
Very. Almost like a missed opportunity, really.
Yeah, but okay.
So, people can find your website.
Always can write me.
How can they get in touch if they want to share recordings with you or reach out in any way?
Oh, yes. When you go to the website, it's www.harrysparnay.info.
There we go. That's the one, yeah.
And and then you can write and I get it. I always answer.
Always answer your email?
Yeah, always. Always answer.
So that's www.harrysparnay.info, and that's harrysparnay.info. Yeah. And you can find his email address on there and get in touch. Is there any last thing you'd like to share with the clarinet audience?
I love to speak with you, and I hope I get a lot of reactions. And I always, when there are questions, please write me. I have time enough now, and I answer. And when they find, of course, a recording, please send me.
If I get some questions and stuff, would you be willing to come on for a second episode in the future?
Of course.
Perfect.
Of course, no problem.
Well, thank you so much for coming on the show today, Harry.
Okay, thank you.
And that concludes today's rebroadcast of the episode with Harry Sparnay, which first aired in June 2016. I'm wondering if anyone actually did send him some recordings. I really hope so, but unfortunately we sort of lost touch after the interview was recorded, and it's one of those things I always mean to get back in touch with him, and I just didn't. I did not ever reach out to him for a second episode, which is, at this point, it's truly unfortunate. It's not that, you know, it's just the Clarinet podcast. It's not really that big of a deal in the grand scheme of things, but it would have been just such a pleasure to speak to him again and learn even more about his amazing career. And I hope that those who did have the chance to study with him personally will share their experiences with the next generation of clarinetists, which he undoubtedly inspired in many, many ways. So thank you again, Harry, for a wonderful life, a wonderful career, wonderful contributions to the clarinet community worldwide, and my condolences to all who are affected by this loss. Thanks so much for listening, and tomorrow I'll be returning to the scheduled programming, which was a conversation with Cornel Volak about articulation techniques. Today's episode of the podcast was brought to you in part by Mo Bleichner Music Distribution as our hosting sponsor. You can check out their new product, the $49 Match Pitch Barrel, at clarinet.com/store. Also, of course, the podcast was brought to you by our season sponsor, Didario Woodwinds. Thank you so much for listening.
Sanding, shaping, balancing. For centuries, mastering your instrument meant mastering these crafts too. But now, Didario is refining craftsmanship for the 21st century by refining their reeds and mouthpieces with the world's most innovative techniques, so you can spend less time sanding, shaping, and balancing, and more time perfecting your own craft. To learn more about the new era of craftsmanship from Didario Woodwinds, visit didario.com/woodwinds.